Hey everyone, Noah Zerbe here. This is one of a series of short videos looking at problems of game theory and interaction relations. In particular, this video looks at the Monty Hall problem. So let's get started. The Monty Hall problem is named after the host of a 1960s game show called Let's Make a Deal.
These people, dressed as they are, come from all over the United States to make deals here in the marketplace of America. Let's make a deal! And now, here's America's top trader, TV's big dealer, Monty Hall!
In every show, one of the games involved a contestant getting to choose between three curtains. Behind two of the curtains was a goat or some other zonk, a losing prize. And behind one of the curtains was a big prize, like a new car or something of the sort. As the host, Monty knows what's behind each of the three doors. That is, he knows which door contains the prize and which of the two doors are losers. Now, Monty asks the contestant to choose a door. Let's say they choose door number three. Now remember, Monty knows what's behind each door, and so he opens and reveals one of the losing doors, let's say door number two. At that point, and this is the important part, Monty then asks, you originally choose door number three. Would you like to stick with door number three, or would you like to switch to door number one? What would you do? Would you stick to your initial choice of door number three, or would you switch to door number one? And does sticking with your initial choice or switching to the other door change your odds of winning? This problem was first published in the New York Times, and when it was, it stumped a lot of well-educated people, including many mathematicians. A study of the show revealed that only 13% of the contestants actually made the switch when given the option to change their door after revealing a losing door. But you should always switch when given the choice, because your odds of winning increase from 1 in 3 to 2 in 3. That is, from 33% to 66% when you make the choice to switch. Why? There's a couple of ways to think about this. We can look at the payoff matrix represented in this chart. Remember that we had a 1 in 3 chance of choosing the car with our first guess. That means there was a 2 in 3 chance that it was behind one of the other doors. These odds don't change because Monty Hall revealed the goat. Remember, he knows what's behind each door. And if the car was behind door number 1 when we chose it, if we switch, we lose. But there's a 2 in 3 chance, that is a 66% chance, it was behind one of the other doors when we made our initial choice. So 2/3 of the time, we'd be better off switching. Or maybe think of it this way. What if Monty gave us the choice of choosing up to 2 of the 3 doors when we initially made our choice? If that's the case, we'd be better off choosing 2 doors, and we'd have 2/3 of a chance of winning the game. That's basically what he's doing by revealing the remaining door. He's giving us the option to switch to cover 2 of the 3 doors, even if he reveals one of them as a loser. Or put another way, there was a 1 in 3 chance that you picked the car with your first choice, and a 2 in 3 chance that you picked a goat with your first choice. If you pick the car with your first choice, and you stick, you'll win the car. If you switch, you'll lose. But if you chose a goat with your first pick, and there, remember there was a 66% chance that you did, if you switch, you'll win. Thus, 66% of the time, you win if you switch, but only 33% of the time will you win if you stick with your first choice. And if you still don't believe me, you can try playing the game yourself online by following the link on this page, then come back and watch the rest of the video. Now, as I said before, only 13% of the people in the original show actually made the switch. Why didn't more people make the change? The Monty Hall problem illustrates two basic issues. First, it shows that as human beings, we're pretty poor judges of risk and probability. Why are most people more afraid to fly than to drive when we know that flying is safer than driving? Why are we afraid of the risk of a nuclear meltdown despite such events being quite rare? And why are we afraid of sharks and other predators, but not generally afraid of mosquitoes, which are the deadliest animal in the world, responsible for many more deaths in one day, than sharks? Studies show that we tend to overestimate the probability of high-level or dramatic events and underestimate the probability of low-level events. After Malaysian Airlines Flight 370 disappeared in 2014, lots of people were worried about flying. And while the loss of 239 lives in that disappearance is tragic, an estimated 3,000 people die every day from malaria. An estimated 1,600 people die every day from heart disease in the United States. But we as a social group are more concerned about statistically rare but headline-grabbing events than we are about real daily threats we face. Paul Slovic's work on risk is insightful here. He argues that we tend to overestimate the level of risk when a danger has specific qualities. These include the catastrophic potential. We judge dangers as riskier when lots of people are affected at once, rather than when small numbers are affected over a longer period of time. We tend to be more accepting of risk with which we're familiar. A risk that isn't common knowledge is perceived as more dangerous than one that is. This is perhaps why we tend to dismiss the risk of mosquitoes, for example. We tend to view things we don't understand as riskier than things we do. We tend to view things that are not under our control as riskier than those that are perceived to be under our control. Think of being the driver of a car versus a passenger on an airplane. The degree of voluntariness affects our perception of risk. We tend to be more willing to accept risk if we have a choice to participate in the risky event. Think of our willingness to engage in activities like scuba diving or rock climbing or parachuting. The age of victims influences risk perception. Risks that pose a threat to children are generally viewed as more dangerous than those that threaten adults. Victim identity can also influence perceived risk. Incidents which affect higher profile or known individuals are more powerful than those that affect large numbers of people that are unknown to us. It's believed that the large number of victims tends to numb our view of the specific threat. And finally, the origin of the risk tends to influence our perception of it. That is, risks created through human activity tend to be viewed as more dangerous than those occurring naturally. A great example of how poorly we understand risk and probability is provided by the roulette wheel in Las Vegas. In roulette, bettors place wagers on numbers or colors that the ball will land on a spinning wheel. If you match the number or the color, you win. Most casinos now have signs that track the results of previous spins, showing you the numbers and colors on which the ball has landed over the last 10 or 15 or 20 spins, and telling you whether a particular number or color is hot or cold. But what does this mean? Is the past result any indication of future probability? If the ball has landed on black 6 times in a row, does that mean that it's likely to land on black a 7th time, or does that mean that red is overdue and more likely to come up? Actually, it means neither. Each spin is a completely independent event. The ball doesn't remember the last 6 spins. The odds of coming up black again are the same as they were on the last spin, no more and no less. And yet we know, or at least the casinos know, that giving people this useless piece of information encourages them to bet more money on the outcome of the next spin. A second issue that the Monty Hall problem illustrates for us is the endowment effect, or sometimes called divestiture aversion. The endowment effect basically says that we tend to overvalue things we already have and undervalue things we don't. An easy way to think about this is to browse through Craigslist ads and ask why someone thinks their stained, used couch is worth $300. In more theoretical terms, what it means is that our willingness to pay, that is, the maximum amount we'd be willing to pay for something, is generally lower than our willingness to accept, the minimum amount we'd take to sell something. Now, in the abstract, our willingness to pay and our willingness to accept should be roughly close to equal. That is, the maximum price we're willing to pay for something should be about equal to the minimum price we're willing to sell it for. But numerous studies confirm that this is rarely the case. Instead, as individuals, we're generally willing to pay less to purchase an item than when we require to sell that same item. That is, our willingness to pay is generally considerably lower than our willingness to accept, and in some studies it's shown to be up to 10 times lower. The difference between our willingness to pay and willingness to accept is called the endowment effect, or divestiture aversion. It's the idea that we hold on to things, or decisions, or ideas more tightly once we own them. Beyond looking just at the ownership of things, it also suggests that we're likely to stick with bad decisions even when we know they're bad. We're invested in them. And all too often, the worse a decision appears, the more we invest in it. We believe we have to turn things around, that we're overdue for a break, and we've stuck it out this far, so we may as well see it through to the end. What does this have to do with international relations? It suggests that decision makers may invest everything in a decision even when they don't fully understand the risks and rewards, and will stick with the initial decision even if it turns out to be misguided or based on poor information. Take American involvement in Vietnam. The U.S. initially deployed forces to Vietnam in 1955, initially beginning with military advisors and following the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, U.S. ground forces in 1965. All told, the United States was in Vietnam for 19 years and saw almost 60,000 Americans killed in combat. More than 1 million military personnel and as many as 2 million civilians on both sides were killed in fighting. How is this an example of the endowment effect? Simple. For nearly 20 years, every time the Americans suffered a setback in the conflict, from the 1964 U.S. offensive to the airstrikes in Laos to the Tet Offensive in 1967, in every turn, U.S. policymakers believed that they just needed a few more soldiers, a bit more time to guarantee victory. Even as U.S. forces were evacuating the embassy and fleeing Saigon in 1975, U.S. policymakers continued to believe that they had made the correct decisions and just needed more time. We also see the endowment effect play out in the context of global environmental politics, which we'll return to in another video. So that concludes our consideration of the Monty Hall problem and our introduction to the problem of rationality in international relations. I hope you found it useful. If you have any questions, leave them below, and please be sure to check out the other videos in this series. Thanks, everyone. Bye.